Last week we had a detailed message about Ephesus. There's a lot of information thrown at you, and if it's too much, praise the Lord, we are feeding on YouTube, and you can see it again. Matter of fact, I was talking to a friend in Pennsylvania, and they said, well, we're about 2-3 weeks behind you back here. And so they ended up getting the material because they were out visiting, and then they talked about 4 or 5 families, and so all these people back in Lewistown are watching the series, and they're behind, they're trying to catch up, and others are actually just getting ready to start. So, hey, everybody, back in Pennsylvania, glad you can be a part of this, and it's just been wonderful to see how many people are tuning in and seeing what's going on here in this study. And all I can say is no one is having more fun than me. I absolutely have loved walking through, and I'm still learning. I was talking to Martin and a couple other guys about how, you know, every time you go through something like this, there's just that new nugget that you just didn't know, and you get this, and then you get energized and see what God is up to, and it's great. I am going to rehearse a little bit from last week. You probably noticed I didn't use my notes very much because I studied all this stuff out and I got all this new material. So you were my guinea pigs with that last study on Ephesus. There was a lot of new things that I hadn't studied out before. So to give an abridged version of what we learned about last week out of the notes, you can learn about the church at Ephesus. And I add this to tonight's lesson on Smyrna. You can't go to the book of Acts or anywhere else except for the Revelation to learn about the church that we're going to study about tonight. This is all we know about this church. But Ephesus, all kinds of material in chapter 18 of the book of Acts, and other areas that it's talked about, 1 Corinthians 15. And basically God is telling this church, I know what's going on. I know about your works. They've been hard workers, and this is going to be rehearsed tonight. He gives all these words of encouragement. You know, they're not letting these imposters come in. They don't hold on to the doctrines of the Nicolaitans. They hate the evil. And so that was a lot of it. But the rebuke had to do with the relationship with Jesus Christ. It seems like they stopped loving Christ the way they once did. And so we have to guard our hearts as Christians and churches that we don't go forward with ministry without the proper motive, and that proper motive is love. That's why 1 Corinthians, it gets into the details. If you don't do it with love, it is absolutely worthless. It's in vain. So coupling then truth with love is what we're called to do. Sometimes we can have all this truth, but if we don't love and we don't have mercy, we don't have these right characteristics that God gives us, then we're doing it in vain. And then the other side of it, sometimes there's so much love, 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 it's not coupled with truth. Because we have to have both. And so this church seemed to be one-sided, and that's where we have to be careful. And it seems like a lot of this imbalance is happening in churches, and that's where we always have to guard our hearts. We have to guard our church to make sure that we are balancing truth with love, because these folks, they just lost their first love. And that love for Christ seemed to go, and it seemed like I do this, and they did their checklist of I did this, I didn't do that, so therefore I'm a really good Christian. I'm doing everything I'm supposed to do. And it's as though they lost their love for people, for the lost, or one another. And so quickly the rebuke came to this church. It's interesting when Jesus said, he that hath an ear, let him hear. What he's talking about is we need to listen. We need to take heed to what is being said. A blessing will be given to those that have victory over the failures Jesus revealed to them. In other words, there needed to be a rechanging and a coming back. And that's where the overcoming comes in. And it's interesting in 1 John 5 where he tells us, who is he that overcometh? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Christ. So there's how we become overcomers, if you didn't know that. Even the church is called, there's an overcoming, it's based on faith. But the first faith is in Jesus Christ, and that's how we overcome sin, overcome the world, is by faith and believing in Jesus Christ. Let's go ahead and read our text now in Revelation chapter number 2. We're going to start in verse number 8, reading through verse number 11. And unto the angel, or the pastor of the church in Smyrna, write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works, and tribulation, and poverty. Thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, ye may be tried. Ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Lord, as we enter your word now, use this time for your glory and for your honor. Help me as I help your people. Lord, we are here because we want to hear your word. We want to hear about our future. But we also, in this text, want to hear about what is happening now with churches. And Lord, there's different churches that are represented in this building tonight, those who are listening online. And God, we have to look, where are we at as a church? What is the spirit of the church? What is our heartbeat? What are we all about? God, forgive us when we put ourselves in front of you, ahead of you. Help us, Lord, when church becomes a business, when it becomes a popularity contest. Forgive us, Lord, when we do it all wrong. Lord, if there's one thing that we see in the Scriptures that brings the church back to its knees in humility, it is persecution. So, Lord, we learn tonight about the persecuted church. And help us to embrace it if and when it comes to us. Help us to understand this important book. And help us to understand this important letter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A lot of background with this church, but it is more historical than it is biblical because there's not a lot outside of this church. It's about 35 miles from the last church that we talked about at Ephesus. Matter of fact, let's go ahead and read the first paragraph in our notes. Page 20 is where we're at tonight. I should have said that earlier. Page number 20. The church at Smyrna is known as the persecuted church. There's no mention of the church in other scriptures outside of the Revelation. Historians believe it was started by the church at Ephesus. It's only 35 miles away from Ephesus, so it would make sense that the church was involved with its conception. There is no condemnation to this church from Jesus Christ. Only encouragement, which in and of itself is amazing. I mean, if Jesus were talking to you, do you think he'd find some criticism? For this church to not have criticism from Christ, to me, is amazing. Not the only one, but there's others we'll see. But this church definitely is highlighted as the model church. Church of Thessalonica was another model church when you read it, the letters given to it. There's very, very little rebuke. Now, he did say in the one letter, it's the second chapter, he says, now, when I come to you, I'm going to perfect that which is lacking in you. And what he meant is there is still some maturity that needed to happen. But most of the letters that go to that church are encouragement. They come out of incredible idolatry or serving the Lord, etc. So we do have some really good churches. I was driving down the road, and this church was named something about the church at Corinth. That's what they decided to name the church, and associating it with the church at Corinth. I wouldn't call mine First Corinth Church, because there's not a whole lot of good happening with that church. It was about as worldly and carnal as you get. And so, anyways, there's something in the name, isn't there? There is something in the name. So this church, Smyrna, has some background with its name. When you look at, again, where it's located, another church that's located, seaport area, so it has a lot of influence from other nations. And this particular area had a market on a spice that you know well as myrrh. Matter of fact, Egypt and others would go specifically to this area because they had the corner on this. They were the place to go to. It is very likely that Egypt would have come up to get this myrrh, and the reason is it was very important spice when it came to the death of people, because myrrh was part of the spice that they would put in as they would do the burial. It's interesting that myrrh is what one of the wise men brought for Christ. Most likely, they would have gotten it from here, because this was the place that they sold it. And you'll also know that myrrh would have been part of the spice that they would have been bringing to Jesus after he had died. Remember how the women were coming to the tomb and they were bringing spices? Myrrh would have been most likely one of them that would have come from, again, this area. This, it's interesting too, the history behind this area. Before Alexander the Great, this area was absolutely destroyed. And it was interesting, after it was basically brought into ruins, and again, it was very fertile. I mean, it was like able to produce. There was nothing wrong with the area, the land and everything. It was really a great area, but it was wiped out. And when Alexander the Great came in, he looked at this and it's like he was moved with compassion to rebuild, and it was rebuilt. And so their theme was, we were once dead and we came back to life. So that's how they saw themselves, as a resurrected city. It's interesting that when you think of a death and a resurrection, and myrrh being part of all of this, thought of this blessing for the dead, that's what a lot of the spices were, was more idolatry, because they would put the spices in and hopes that would be helping them for the life afterward. And so there's, of course, a lot of idolatry that went in with many of these countries that did it, but myrrh was definitely used. The early church went through a lot of persecution. The community now in Turkey is Izmir, or Izmir, however you pronounce it, for today's location of the church at Smyrna. And this early church went through a lot of persecution, as we've already read in the text. Matter of fact, some of them even unto death. The history behind this incredible place is very deep. The Smyrna, for the early church, was the area where they were really, really attacking the believers. What they would oftentimes do is, as they would come in and arrest them, because they were Christians, they would throw them into jail, not like our jails where you get 3 square a day. No TVs and anything. So what they would have is basically rats climbing over top of them, and they were in dungeons. Basically what they were waiting for is to find out if they were going to be part of the games, where they would take them and either have them fed to the lions, or if they were going to be burned at the stake. But this early church was slandered. Matter of fact, because of their morality and because of them being followers of Christ coming out of the idolatry, accusations quickly were spreading through the community about this early church. And what they were saying was basically, they are anti-family because they have communion. They were teaching that the church were cannibals and that Christ was a cannibal. They would also teach that they were part of the love feast, the sexual immorality. So this is the rumors that were being spread around the area about this church. And all that they would needed to do was to come to a church service and realize that anything but that was happening. By the way, when we do right, that's when you expect the slander. When you do what's right, that's when we get attacked. If we're going along with the flow, if we're just trying to blend in, you're not going to get opposition. It is when you become light that darkness hates you, and they're going to go after you. Marvel not that the world hates you. Remember that one? And why are we surprised when we're attacked? Sadly, much of the attack that comes to Christianity are religious people. Follow me? It's not the barbaric people out there. They're doing their own thing. It's those that are trying to have the, if you will, it's the battle of the gods. It's the battle of the church. It's the battle who's right, who's wrong. It seems like the attack comes from religious organizations. But here, we see in this text, we even have those who are saying they're of the synagogue, they're Judaism, but they really weren't. Though again, the early church was attacked by the Jews, Judaism. Galatians, you can see it in all many scriptures, how there is opposition. They would come into the church and try to sway people and pull them out of grace and liberties. Remember, I'm going through Galatians and my devotions right now. And it's like there was this one time where he says there were people that were trying to spy out our liberties. Can you imagine coming in? It's like, let's see what they allow themselves to do. Oh, they had pork chops. You know, they're trying to find something to pounce on. Do you do that? Do you individually wait for one thing to be said, one thing you disagree with? You're just waiting for that one thing, and then the attack. I see that in Christianity, by the way. It's sad that we become that. Sometimes we become what we hate. So we have to be careful that we judge with grace. The Testament, God says, I love mercy. We should love mercy. He is full of grace and truth. We should love grace and truth. It seems like we are more like the Pharisees, just waiting. But he broke the Sabbath day. Doesn't matter, the guy's hand was healed. He did it on a Saturday. How dare he? And we try to pick something out to attack. Sadly, that's what I was raised with fundamentalism. And I have no time for it anymore. My job is to preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. So, we teach truth. We reveal what's error. And then we practice it. And God takes care of the rest, I feel. This church was attacked horribly. We'll get into a little bit more of the persecution in just a couple of minutes. Verse number 8, you'll see point number 1. I'm going to try to stay to my notes tonight. I'm proud of me. Verse number 8, point number 1, is another confirmation of this church that Jesus, who is the first and the last, we've seen that quite a few times, haven't we, in this book already, who also, in adding on this, died for them and rose again from the dead, is watching them, and that he cares. Nothing happens to his church from the outside or within his church without him knowing. Will we care for little eyes? Remember, for all that? Careful little ear to hear? To the Father up above, looking down at line. So be careful. And sometimes you think, yeah, but I have righteous indignation. I have every right to do this. I don't. It's sin, it's sin. Wrong is wrong, right? Not that hard. So what we have to be careful of is, as rebukes are coming to Jesus, but we also have to remember, when we go through hardship and persecution, he is also watching. And we think, you know, the Old Testament, you know, David's like, Lord, how long until you kill my enemies? That's not your prayer now. Okay? That's not what it's about. It's not about vengeance and getting after them. It is just us taking as Christ did, the suffering, the fellowship of the suffering with Christ. And we do it patiently, as Peter talks about. And then God says, I'm going to reward you one day for it. And the mindset, if we're going to connect the dots here tonight, the Word of God with suffering, is God actually instructs us how to do it. He says, take it with patience. Patience. That's that word we hate to hear. Because I'm impatient, I want everything now, fix it now, kill them now, let me have a nice life. You know, that's not the way it works. These people were enduring for years the hardships and the persecution. And so we take it with patience. And we take this suffering because we did the right thing. If we suffer for doing wrong, there's no glory in that. If you're in jail for doing something illegal, well, you can't say, well, I'm being persecuted. No, you're not. You were stupid. And now you're in jail. Okay? Don't blame God for that one. That's you being stupid, okay? But if you're doing right and you suffer, God says, do it patiently. Just hang in there. Allow me to be God, and I'll take care of you. And that's where we become an incredible, incredible light. So God does have a format for us how we should be handling the hardship. And this church did it right. And everything that they were going through, every person that was killed, every person that was beat up and thrown in jail, Jesus in heaven is watching and knowing everything. And as we're going to get into in a little bit, they will receive a crown of life for it. So there's a reward for suffering. And I'll say it now because I'll forget probably later on. As Christians, we either win or we win. If we don't go through persecution, praise the Lord, we win. But if we do suffer, even martyrdom, we still win. And that's how we have to see our lives. That's why God uses the word hope. We have something always to look forward to as Christians. Verse number 9, point number 2, God reveals their problems. They were working diligent. And by the way, God sees our work. The Greek word ergon, which means to toil, is to perform deeds, is a labor because of their circumstances. And when you're going through persecution, it's going to be harder. That's why he uses the word labor. I know your works, everything is hard. Just going to church, not knowing who was watching. Coming to church, not knowing who was the spy. Not knowing, everything is a burden and a work. Extra money because so-and-so, their husband just was put in jail, and now we have a dear family over here. They don't have any food. We need to give a little bit more so that they have something to eat, and the kids have something to eat. It's more work for those who are working. It's more energy expended. Everything is harder when persecution comes, and yet, as we know, the blessings come as a result. Their tribulation is also mentioned. Now, this means to be burdened or to be in anguish, afflicted, and persecuted. I do want to highlight this. This is not in reference to the great tribulation. Even though God uses the word tribulation here, he's not talking about what is going to be coming, because as we explained a few weeks ago, tribulation that is coming from God, the great tribulation, which is a 7-year time period, is God's wrath on this earth. This tribulation that these people are going through is man to man. Humans to humans. So this is persecution that is coming their way. This type of a tribulation that they are going through is a burden. It's a hardship. And point C is what is the result. Their poverty is also seen. They're losing their jobs, being robbed, punished for being Christians. Jesus said, they are physically poor, but spiritually rich. So, which would you rather have? Which would you, if here it is, spiritual riches, but poor as dirt, or all kinds of resources, do anything you want, but you have no spiritual wealth? Which would you honestly, in your heart, choose if you had that ability? Sadly, oftentimes, when we choose spiritual wealth, oftentimes the physical is limited because we're not willing to compromise. We're not willing to lie at work. We're not willing to fudge the numbers. We don't get that bonus as a result. We're not fraudulent. We're not stealing from somebody else so that we can have. And I'm preaching to preachers too. Because even the leadership, so sadly, I've seen through the years how many men, they start out really well. and then they're not making the money, they're not having the success, they didn't, so they begin to become fraudulent and take money from the church and steal from other Christians, and they take and they take and take, because they are choosing, instead of spiritual wealth, they desire to have the physical. We had this guy that was at our one church, and I don't know, he was, you know, very intelligent, doctor so-and-so, great historian, and you know, when we were at the house just having a time of fellowship, after it was all said and done, my wife said, "I don't trust that guy." I'm like, "Are you kidding? That's Dr. So-and-so. Of course he's an excellent man. You know, I don't like, there's something about this guy." I'm like, "Gentlemen, learn to listen to your wives." It was after the conference was over, we got the phone call from his local, his home church, and they said, "We have to have some questions for you. Did our Dr. So-and-so stay at such and such hotel while he was speaking at your conference?" "No, he stayed with this family." "Okay. Thank you. We need to reveal to you what he has been doing as he goes around the country speaking at other churches. He says he's staying at a hotel, and he fabricates these bills that he paid out of pocket, and then the church reimburses him these thousands and thousands of dollars, and he doesn't put this money out, so it's an extra paycheck for him." And so he was doing that, and they found out he was sleeping with four different women in the church. My wife was right. There's something creepy about that guy, you know. And she was right. He was a womanizer. A lot of, sadly, and people of influence can go that route. It's so sad. And so they loved the pleasure. They loved the stuff. They guesstimated it was about $100,000 that he had taken from the church over the course of years. He was an author, getting money from that. But when you're greedy, enough, just never enough. So they didn't choose they didn't choose the physical wealth. They chose to suffer with Jesus. There's another church we're going to learn later on. You think you're rich, and yet you're poor. Poor spiritually. So this seems to be a theme for the churches, doesn't it? So we have to look at ourselves as Christians and churches to say, what are we really all about? Is it about the physicality? Is it about the numbers? Is it about the money? Or is it about the spiritual welfare? Is it about the soul? Is it about true spirituality? Because sadly, oftentimes we are compromising for numbers instead of revealing truth. Yeah. I'll be careful. I got more stories, but I won't. Because, I don't want this to be, every church is negative. It's all about, it's not that way. I think there's some really great churches that are doing a great job reaching people with the gospel of Christ, and it's not about the money. But I tell you right now, it just seems like it is absolutely a fiasco. Who can do the biggest gimmick to get more people in, and then we can count the numbers and count the sheep, and so therefore we're the fastest growing church in America. Who cares? I'm telling you now, some of the greatest preaching I ever heard were from pastors in little country churches. And I mean, these guys flat out knew the word. And they were preaching truth. And no, they didn't have the bells and whistles and the smoke. And I don't think God's worried about bells, whistles, and smoke. I think he's worried about truth. So these people chose to be spiritually rich. I gave you a couple of verses there in point C, highlighted 2 Corinthians 6:10. "As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, and yet possessing all things. Having food and raiment, let us be therewith content." To have a little bit is enough. David even brought that concept up. Solomon, is just like, "Lord, put me right in the middle. Don't make me poor. Don't want to steal. Don't make me rich, or I might take your name in vain. Might forget you. put me right in the middle. Isn't the middle like a nice place to be, blue collar, if you will? You know, you work hard, you get a little bit, your bills are paid, praise the Lord. No, you don't have a Mercedes and you don't have, you know, all the gadgets and everything, but guess what? Life is good. Find that place of contentment. These people found that. And what they were able to do with this is they were able to reach many to get into as a result. Spiritually rich. 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, that you, through His poverty, might be rich." Rich with money. Not a prosperity gospel here, folks. Rich spiritually. Because that is ultimately what counts. Letter D. Satan comes up next. Satan was using those pretending to be Jews to blaspheme the church. The word blasphemy in the text means to speak evil of someone, railing, to vilify. And this is the place where Satan was ultimately working. And he was using the Jews to come in to try to dissemble the assembly, trying to break them down, attacking and persecuting. It's interesting, over in verse 13, we highlighted this earlier. I want you to read verse 13 with the next church, Pergamos. Lord willing, we'll see in a couple weeks. "I know thy works," you'll notice that's a theme, "and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is." You imagine Satan picking out your church of all the churches in the world because he's not omnipresent. Satan can only be one place at a time. And if he decides, "I'm going to Pergamos, that's where I'm going to hang out for a while. I'm going to sit down here and I'm going to attack this church. Because if I can rip this church to shreds, the gospel light is going to be snuffed out. And now the rest of the world will go on their merry way committing idolatry, and they're going to be lost, and they're going to perish, and they're going to go to hell. They're going to be standing at the great white throne judgment to be cast into the lake of fire, and that's Satan's job, is to deceive and kill." Satan was working here, and Satan uses man. Satan uses religions. Satan knows the Word of God really well. And he knows how to twist it, to take truth and put it to the side, to zero on the minor things rather than the most important things. You see, how do you know that? Well, remember when Jesus said, "They're straining at the gnat, swallowing the camel." This metaphor is, you know, they would take, you know, when they had their wine, and they would put this strainer over top of it, and that way when they were pouring, they could get all the little bugs out of it. You know, nothing, you know, drink that stuff then, you know. So they're straining gnats. They're straining the wee, wee little things that are microscopic. So it's like, yeah. And yet you're swallowing a huge thing. You're worried about the little thing, straining it, and yet you're just like opening your big fat mouth and taking in this huge animal. You're missing the big picture, in other words. Religion is good at that. Pharisees were masters at that. Zeroing in on these insignificant things, and they're missing it. They're looking at, "I don't allow milk and meat to be served at the same time." And yet they miss the Messiah. I call that missing the big picture. Satan used these Jews that were saying they're Jews, but they really weren't Jews. If you read Romans chapter 9, you'll get into the detail of what a real Jew was. A real Jew was a Jew of the heart, not a person that was born a Jew. It was one who has believed in the Messiah. So even in the Old Testament, there were those who were, quote-unquote, part of Israel, but they really weren't part of Israel because they were not circumcised in their heart. They didn't believe God the way they should. That's why God highlights those in Hebrews 11 who really, in the Old Testament, believed God. And as he described in Romans chapter 4, how Abraham, pre-law, believed God and was counted unto him for righteousness. And then it says, David also, it was described of him that there was a blessing to those that God would not impute sin onto their account. Why? Because they believed God. So pre-law, during law, both times of the Old Testament were called to faith. Next page. Page number 21, point number 3. And verse 10. Let's go ahead and read that verse first before we get into some important doctrines, I feel. Verse 10. I know you're going back and forth between your notes and your Bible, and I know it's really hard. It's like, why can't we just get tables here for everybody to put your notes and your Bible down? I apologize, I'm back and forth. I got it made. I got this desk up here. I'm good. Verse 10. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. How many times does God come to the disciples and come to other people and say, fear not? He's coming to the church now with those same words. Stop fearing. Don't fear. Can I ask us a question as a church and individual? What are we afraid of? What when you are by yourself and laying down on the couch, or getting ready to go to sleep, and your mind is just wandering? What fears come into your mind? Fear of losing health, fear of losing wealth, you know, what happens to my 401k, retirement, you know, what if, you know, what if we get attacked, what if bad things really happen? That's usually what we're going through in our minds, and all the what ifs, and we begin to fear. You'll remember that fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. In other words, we are not understanding the love of God if we as Christians walk through this life with fear. Here again, God says, get the fear out. Faith overcomes our fears. Some of you knew about me, and I had a scan on my chest, and they found two nodules, and it was the type of nodules they said typically is a slow-growing cancer in my lung. And, of course, I kept it myself, as the guys do, and didn't tell Lori, didn't tell the family. Caleb, after he found out, he's like, Pops, what were you thinking, man? Tell us, you know, I didn't want to burden people. And my wife was like, were you afraid? You know, what was going through your mind? Because all the reports and everything I read, and even the nurse, Mr. Henry, you're telling her voice, Mr. Henry, we really need to have this other scan. Because this is serious. This is not good. And I'm like, okay. You know? And my wife's like, how are you doing? I said, listen, we understand, as Christians, we win. Or we win. Okay, so I got lung cancer, and I die in 3 to 5 years from now, you know, if I do treatments, if I don't do treatments, you know, you die of lung cancer, you know? And it's like, okay, so I graduate and go to heaven. Yay, you know? And, you know, so they did the scan, and literally gone. I mean, they're like, nothing there. We're not seeing any problem at all. You know, I'll have a scan every year and everything. The Lord's like, what was going through your mind? And there was two times that I had that little pity party. I did. You know, I'm in my garage. I did over, you know, I'm sitting out there, you know, and reading and thinking. And, you know, what if it is? What should I do? You know, you worry about your wife. You know, you worry about the church, you know. So I had planned out what I was going to do with the church for the next couple of years until I wasn't able to preach anymore. So I had it all laid out, what I was going to preach on my way out. And, you know, what was going on, you know, I need to do this and this and this for my wife, make sure her needs are met. And so I'm walking through all of this, and I'm like, you know, you do this to yourself. Get a hold of yourself. You know what I mean by that? You know, it's like, what are you thinking about? Why are you worried about that? I had two different times I was going through all that pity party, you know. And then God's like, Harold, get up. Get up. You don't even know if you have anything. They don't know if you have anything. So I got up, and that was it. And honestly, before you as a congregation, God gave me an absolute peace in my heart either way. And you go forward, and you stop fearing. Because fear limits. Worries cause things to get worse. Worrying doesn't help. Matter of fact, science has said worry is like the worst thing for you. It does nothing good for us. That's why God says when we have anxiety, what are we to do? I'm pausing because I want you to remember this. Be anxious for nothing but by prayer. So we pray, we give it to God, and then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keeps the hearts and the mind through Christ Jesus connected. And so the preacher had to practice what he preaches. We do fear. We have that tendency. But God is saying, don't fear. Don't fear the suffering. Behold, the devil. He's going to cast you into prison. Now, physically, he didn't come and throw them in. Obviously, Satan in this region was working and using the unsaved world, even some of them religious lost, to have these true believers thrown into prison. Then he says, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Here's what he calls them to be. Not afraid, but be thou faithful unto death, and then comes the crown of life. In our notes, number 3, at the top of page 21, in verse 10, Jesus fortifies the church, strengthens them, in other words, by telling them the harm they will go through. He tells them not to fear. The 10 days of persecution will take place, but they will be reminded to be faithful to Him. The number 10 days, you say, so basically they knew when it was going to begin and end, 10 days. I think God uses the number 10 days as two things. A, the persecution is going to be a limited time. And the number 10, typically in the Scriptures, has to do with a completeness. It's like 10 commandments. Here's the big picture of it all. This is the conclusion of it all. And so he is saying, indeed, for a time period that is complete, you are going to be going through persecution, and it is going to take place. Could God have stopped this? In a moment. Why does God allow the church to go through persecution? If God was a loving God, He would never allow us to go through any hardship here. It would just rain down millions of dollars, and we could be really great witnesses for God if we had it all. And that's what we think. But the persecution and the hardships come for a purpose. God allows it for a purpose. And that is that we would be faithful. That we would be found faithful. Knowing that tribulation worketh patience. Romans chapter number 5. So this hardship that we go through causes us to be able to endure. When we begin to have that patience, then comes the experience, and experience hope, and then hope maketh not ashamed. That's the flow of Romans chapter 5. That's the whole reason that we get to go through. Number one is for our personal relationship with God to get better. Or God's going to reveal that you're getting bitter. If you get bitter, you're not faithful. If we get better because we're trusting God faithful, God is going to cause you then to receive a crown when you stand before Jesus Christ at His judgment seat. So it is, as an individual, to show what's going on inside of us. God has every right to try and to test us. He's the potter, we're the clay. Gary Bennett, loved that man. He was an incredible artist, and if you ever had the privilege of going to his home and him to show you the diverse artwork that he was involved with. But one of the things that I would oftentimes pray or talk about is that very thought. God's the potter and we're the clay. And he would always zero in on that. And one day I was having a message, Jeremiah, talking about that. So he brought all of his tools in. And he began to explain to me each tool and what it was used for. And how sometimes God is adding and there's times that God is carving and taking away. And one of the keys of making this pottery is the pressure. Without the pressure, pottery cannot be formed. And this pressure that we go through is merely God trying to form you into the image of Jesus Christ. Without the pressure coming from God, without the testings and the trials, we will never get better. We're never going to be Christ-like. We must go through it. Philippians chapter 3 tells us that I may know Him, the power of His resurrection, and the fellowship of His sufferings. When we suffer, we fellowship with Christ in a unique way. That's you individually. And can you imagine when testimony after testimony in a given room with this church, how they would talk about how they were beaten, how a loved one was thrown in jail. They would come in with bruises. I lost my job. Broke again. Don't even know how I'm going to get bread. But God says, Lord, give us this day our daily bread. And I have bread for the day. God is good. Might be hungry tomorrow, but today, I got bread today. Praise the Lord. And we're not to take thought and not worry about tomorrow. There's enough evil about tomorrow. Just look at today and seek first the kingdom of God, His righteousness, and all these things, the stuff we need. God says, I'll add it to you. I'll give you what you need. This church got it. And they were faithful through all this hardship and this persecution. And God says, good job. Well done. You're going to be tested. You're going to be tried. You're going to have this tribulation. But the call to them is a call to us. Be faithful, even if it means death. One of the early fathers, you can read this if you get online or get into different books, church history books, but there was one of the early fathers who was a great learner from the disciples. Polycarp was his name. He lived to be 86 years because in his famous quote that God had been faithful to him for those 86 years, how can I deny Him now? This Smyrna is where he gave his life. Much of the persecution was unto death. They would sometimes burn him at stakes, sometimes they'd feed him to the lions. But this man, when he was arrested, I hope I get the whole storyline right, but when they came to arrest him, he talked to his servants and he said, would you please get the meal ready for these who are about to arrest me? And he had a prayer meeting in front of those men as they were prepared to arrest him. And these men, it is told that they said, how can we take this man knowing we're going to arrest him and we're going to have him killed? So their hearts are pierced. But he would not deny the Lord. So he fed his enemy. Sound familiar? Romans 12? So he did. When they were tying him to the stake to be burned, he said, you won't need the ropes. Just put me here at the stake. I'm not going anywhere. And they didn't. A miracle, history records, is that the flame seemed as though it would not hit his body. So the flame seemed to be staying away from his body. So a man was commanded to go up and to pierce him, to kill him. And then he would have been burned. And that was happening regularly for a long period of time. And God says, I see your persecution. I see your faithfulness. I see what's going on in your heart. That you love spiritual. And the physical is not what is number one. Oh, that we as Christians would have that order. That spiritual is number one and the physical is down here. Not the most important. In America, we love stuff so much. We love popularity, we love the brag of the toys we have, we love the stuff. I'm not saying it's wrong to have toys. Nothing wrong with that. But the key is that we love God, and if we lost all those toys, who cares? See the attitude we have? We have it, we enjoy it while we have it. It's all Lord's anyway. And then we find this contentment and this this church founded, and God's commending them for it. He closes this down, and I got to close down, don't I? He says, as a result of faithfulness unto death, I will give thee a crown of life. One of the five crowns that many see in the New Testament. Crowns for the church. Crowns for Christians. There is a crown of rejoicing, a crown of righteousness, a crown of glory, a crown of life, as we're seeing here, and an imperishable crown. Rejoicing, righteous, glory, life, imperishable. The word for crown is similar to that name, Stephen, Stephanos. And that's where the thought of crown. And if you remember, Stephen, and the deacon in the early church, was the one who became the first recorded martyr. And they stoned him to death. And while he was crying up to the Lord, it's like, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. So he's pleading for his enemy. Pray for your enemy. Pray for them, not against them. See the difference? And then he says, oh, I see the Lord standing up in heaven. And he did. He knew the Lord Jesus was watching. He saw the rocks. And they weren't little rocks that we would throw as kids. They were rocks. They were crushed bones. Broken ribs, broken chest, broken skull. Buried out of absolute hate. In Jewish love, of course. They thrived on this. Stone them. What do we do with this woman caught in adultery? The law says stone. What do you say, Jesus? Well, you don't got any sin? You cast the first stone. This crown is for you. This crown is for me. If I go through the hardship and the sufferings, if I would give my life, there is this crown if I do it in love. Not for self, not for image, not to become a martyr that my name goes down in history. No, no, no. It is for the cause of Christ. Go to James in chapter 1, verse 12. James 1 and verse 12. James 1, 12. Blessed. Another way of saying happy. Inside, a man is jubilant. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. Do you love Jesus? Do you love God? Are you willing to suffer for him? Would you be willing, by his grace, to even give your life for Christ? If you have that love, and you were to suffer, and you were even to have to give your life, God says, when you are standing before me at the judgment seat of Christ, Christ himself, who was murdered, the one who gave his life so that we become spiritually rich, if we are allowing ourselves to be physically hurt, lose it all for spiritual gain, God says, I got a crown for you. I'd rather have his crown than the world's crown. Okay? I'd rather have the crown that he's giving out in heaven than anything man could give me. So that's why our motivation is Christians, is to serve him, even if it means they hate me, even if it means I got to give my life, that we love him even unto death. If we endure the suffering and or are killed, we will receive this specific crown. He that hath an ear, let him hear. So point number 4 in verse 11, Jesus again calls out to the churches to listen to his words and obey them. First mention of the second death is given here. No true Christian will be sent to the lake of fire after the great white throne judgment as described in Revelation chapter number 20. So it says in verse 11, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. If you go to the second death in Revelation 20, it's described as the lake of fire. So guess what? You're never going to know what it smells like. You're never going to understand the heat. You're not going to hear the crying, the wailing. You're not going to understand this, if you will, bottomless pit where there's no residency, there's no break. You will never understand the smell of sulfur. You'll never understand that at all. But most importantly, what you, as they who were in hell, will be in a lake of fire, is the key is they are separated from God. And you say, well, what's the big deal with that? Those of us who are in heaven, especially when we get into Revelation 4, 5, and 7, in God's presence, read Isaiah 6. See the glory of God in His train. See, everywhere God is light. Everywhere God is life. Here in hell, darkness, pain, and it's death. That's why my life verse, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that has sent me has everlasting life, shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. If I had died at 17, 18 years old before I trusted Christ as my Savior, I'd have gone to hell. But because when I heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, how he died and rose again for me, and I called on him that day on a porch lane, I literally passed from death to life in a moment. I received eternal life inside of me that God promised for all those that believe. And I trust each one of you have believed in Jesus Christ. And you have that life. Be courageous. When opposition comes, God has called us to be faithful to Him no matter what. And the result is going to be a crown of life one day. Let's stand together. We'll let you go home. Father, this is serious. This, to me, is the nuts and bolts of Christianity. This is what separates those who are on fire for you versus those who are in it for all the wrong reasons. God, forgive us when we're in it for all the wrong reasons. Help us, Lord, to keep it real and to serve you with our whole heart. Help us to be light in a time of darkness. Help us, Lord, to be revealing truth, even though it's not popular. You tell us to be preaching the word the instant in season and out of season. Right now, it does not seem that the word is as popular as it once was, but we are still called to be faithful. May we be faithful in sharing the truth and what you have done in our lives. Help us, Lord, to be prosperous spiritually. Help us to be fruitful. Help us, Lord, be part of your work. And I pray, Father, as we do, we know hardships can come our way as a result. You have called us to do one thing, be faithful. God, help us to be faithful. Dismiss us now, Lord, with your blessing. Take everyone home safely. And God, we thank you, each one that's come out this night. Thank you for what you'll do. Pray by faith and always according to your will. In Jesus' name, amen.